Shabbat shalom to all of you. This parasha is called Ki Tisa. And this is the portion that we are going to find the very difficult part about Israel, about the sin of Israel against the Creator, the making of an idolatrous a calf of gold, and they worship it, this calf of gold. What is interesting is you go back to chapter 20, you're going to see the very specific when the Torah was given to Israel. You're going to see that immediately the Creator not only tells them that He is the one that brought them out of Egypt, who liberated them out of Egypt. And then after that, He said, you shall not make any likeness of image of me, about me, from animals, things on the land, or anything like that. And that is exactly what these people did when they made the golden calf. What happened is that doing that, even used the same word that was given in the beginning of the giving of the Torah. And they say, this is the God who has taken you out of Israel, of Egypt. They use that word, looking at the golden calf, and then they worship. Now, our sages are trying to defend this situation as much as they can. And they're trying to clean the name of Israel. And we need to be honest from the beginning that there has been a very big sin. Even some of our sages, they tell us that if they didn't commit this sin, we will never need a mikdash, a tabernacle, that we will never need it to have any special place to where to meet together, because the presence of the Creator, He was going to be dwelling in us, as that was the intention from the beginning, that He was going to be all the time with us. We were the one that carried that relationship. Another thing that our sages tell us is that really was not Israel the ones that they committed the sin of the idolatry. The word, the Ereb Rab, the people, the mixed multitude that left with Israel. And this is blaming others, passing the buck to somebody else. This is another very dishonest way to look at the scriptures. You know, especially because when you read the scripture, you're going to see that the Creator doesn't say this mixed multitude. He say Israel, and say very clear to the Levites, kill your brothers and your friends that they have done that. Your brother and your friend means that are part of Israel. You know, it's very clear that the word was Israel. Now, that was the whole Israel. We think it was not whole Israel, but that was a group of Israel who committed sin. And what was the sin of the others in many ways? That they didn't do anything about it. And who was the greatest culprit of all of this? Aharon, the brother of Moshe Rabbeinu. And I still do not understand myself how our sages trying to defend Aharon to the point that now they are putting him in a very high position. Like I say to you, this is a dilemma that we need to deal with, because we do not understand exactly why Aharon was given the position that he was given after that. You know, some people say that because he was a pacifist, he was a very friendly, he was looking for always for peace and shalom in all the people, you know, that he didn't want to have conflicts, and he was very, very agreeable with everybody else. To me, Aharon, in many ways, has played like a politician. You know, he say yes to everyone, you know, and because he wants to be nice to everyone. And sometimes you need to learn to say no. even if it could be costly your own life. Okay? But there are situations sometimes that you need to say no. Right now, we are facing the situation here in the Western civilization, especially in Canada and United States, with this liberation of mentalities and being more free and more open-minded, you know? And they call you a bigot if you say something that it is against the moral turpitude of humanity. You know, today, we are not allowed even to give an opinion about something that we disagree. You know, we cannot talk about anybody or any religion. That's all, God forbid. With the absolution of my Creator, you know, that we cannot say anything right now, because now we need to be political correct, we need to be theological correct, we need to be sociological correct. And we are afraid to speak. Now we have been mute to the point that they are making laws. No? That if you say something against somebody else, that it's a fact. You know? You are put in jail. You know? And this idea of the freedom of speech has been totally eliminated. And we are going back to the Middle Ages, when you were totally dominated by the powers of the governments, that they will not let you talk or say anything again. That's what happened in the socialist communist countries. Still today, in certain countries, I won't mention countries, because if I may start mentioning countries, they're going to try to say that I am being a bigot. You know, but there are certain countries that if you say something against the country, if you say something against their leaders, you are going to have a very hard situation. And the so-called people here in the Western civilization, they are very advanced according to their thinking. You know, and they defend those who cannot be even defended. They defend those people that are worse in their country than here. And they want to impose their ideas that are in their country, that they supposedly they were free in coming to a free country, now they want to impose it here. Who can understand that mentality? You know? And this is the problem about not to be honest, and you cannot be honest. Aaron was a politician in my understanding, because he played many of the sayings, say that what he was doing is trying to gain time. But if you look at the discourse, at the narrative of this, excuse me, if you look at the narrative, you're going to see that he gives, the Torah gives an idea of what happened. And then when Aaron is questioned by his brother, he gives a totally different account. You know, and one, in the first, at the beginning, very clear say that he asked for the gold, and he was the one that made the golden calf. What happened is after that, when Moshe Rabbeinu comes back and confronts his brother, say, what you have done? How you have done now? I left you here with Hur to be the leaders, and look at you have destroyed Israel with doing this because you allow it. And he say, no, these people are evil. You know? And the only thing is, they gave me the gold, and I threw it in the fire, and voila, came out. You know? Who can believe that? No, in that moment. And you see there that even in the Torah, there is a little bit of a sense of humor. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about all the other questions of Moshe Rabbeinu. Many has asked me, Rabbi, why the Creator repents? You know, because here they say that he repents. When Moshe Rabbeinu changed his mind. Was our greatest teacher, Rambam, Moshe Maimonides, that was telling us that the Torah, he says sometimes, speak in the language of men. And sometimes he give you an idea in order that you are able to understand. And sometimes we misunderstand the Torah because we adjudicate to the Creator totally human conditions. You know, like he has eyes, a mouth, or an arm, or a hand, things like that. You know, he's ethereal. He doesn't have form. No, nobody has seen him. But the language is spoken, they call it anthropomorphic language in the Torah. It is in order to give us a better understanding of the narrative. But I want to go with you to the portion in chapter 32. And I want that you put attention about the dialogue that he has, Moshe Rabbeinu, with the Creator, with Moshe Rabbeinu. Then, beginning from chapter 31:18, and you can go back to chapter 24, and you can put it together, you're going to see that there is seamless. That means that there is not, if you put it together, it's like it's a continuation one or the other. Then they tell you also that this idea that many of the sages tell you, that chapters 25 to 31, 17 are out of place or chronologically in place, and then from 35 to 40, they are together. But this is the idea of the envelope that I already explained to you, to cover the sin of the golden calf through the idea of the tabernacle. And I want that you more or less see it in this way. And he say, when the Lord stopped talking to Moshe in the Har Sinai, in the Mount of Sinai, you know, he gave it the two tablets, no, of the Luchot Edut, these stone tablets of stone, they were written, and here say by the finger of God. You know, that is an anthropomorphic term that I am talking to you. You know, what I want to say it is that was the Creator who made it, who did it. Okay. When and he's going to relate it in chapter 32, the problem of the people of Israel. Moshe went to the mountain to receive the tablets and took a long time. I was sharing with some of you last time that was not long ago that there is a midrash about this portion, from the giving of the Torah to the moment that Moshe Rabbeinu went to the Mount of Sinai, no, and this is that was the wedding between the Creator with Israel. That was a wedding. Yeah, chapter 32. And the wedding is basically start in chapter 19, the preparation in chapter 20 when the Torah is given from Har Sinai, and Moshe Rabbeinu finished giving it. In the Jewish wedding, there are two parts. The one is called the Erusin, and the second part is the Nesuin. That was before that used to be done in two separate occasions. Today, in the Jewish wedding, all is done in one day, all at the time. This is the reason that we have two times that we had the blessing of the Borei Pri Hagafen that is drunk by the groom and the bride, you know, under the chuppah. The chuppah is the covering. Now, supposedly, the erusin is the engagement. It's when the parents, they decided that the couple are going to be together, and they write a contract. The contract is called the ketubah. But it is in the second part, in the nesuin, when the final blessing comes, it's called kedoshim, the sanctification. You know, when both get together and the marriage after the blessing, they receive the ketubah is signed, and the consummation of the marriage. That is a beautiful picture between the wedding between the Creator and Israel. And you're going to see in other prophets that they talk about the Creator marry Israel, and Israel was unfaithful. That's the unfaithful wife. You know, that's always. Now, in order that you understand why there are certain things that comes out here that you need to understand or look at it in a better way. For example, you have the engagement, and then you have the wedding. In the engagement, you know, there's giving the stipulations and the conditions. And finally, in the wedding itself, when there is under the chuppah, you know, they sign the contract. The contract is given to the bride. Remember this, the ketubah is to protect the bride. Okay? Who is the bride? Israel. And who is making the promise that he's going to protect Israel? The Creator. Okay? Look at that picture. Now, if you have gone to Bemidbar and you have, and this Shabbat, by the way, this Shabbat is also called Shabbat Parah. Okay? The red cow. And the red cow has something very interesting that is used later on in the so-called the sota. When the husband is jealous of the wife, they take it to the high priest, and the high priest give it this concoction that is from the red cow and those things that's very similar, you know, and then. They drink it. If she doesn't explode, you know, that means that she has been faithful. You know, you see, Moshe Rabbeinu made the people, they melt and they make a powder of the Egel Zahav, they mix it with water, and they make them to drink. Okay? You see, there are a lot of pictures there that you need to see. Another thing that is very interesting about even that what almost half of Israel explode, there were 3,000 that they were killed by the Levites who joined to Moses against those ones that didn't fulfill, or they were against the sin, and they were against God, or they committed idolatry. The other thing that is important is that later on, even that the Creator forgive them, he gives them a plague, you know, a disease, and many of them die too. That's to tell you that was for those one who really has committed this bad situation. Now, if you look at the picture of the wedding, the Creator could divorce Israel immediately. Yeah. Because Israel was unfaithful. He had a right. And here is where Moshe Rabbeinu intervened. And this is the portion that I want to talk to you, because I want to give you a different view about this. Sometimes I am tired to hear about that God repented or God changed his mind. You know, and sometimes people treat the Creator like a human being. They're wishy-washy. Our Creator is not wishy-washy. He knows from the beginning to the end. He's omniscient. He knows everything before and after. He knew all the things that were going to happen. If he didn't know that all these things were going to happen, he ceased to be a creator. There are many people who say that he limits himself and he's omniscient, and he closed his eyes and he tapped his eyes and he doesn't want to see what is going to happen. You know, that is not my God. Maybe that's your God, but my God is greater than that. What happened that he has given us what I call it the Vehira Hokshi, the free will. And because of that, he himself has limiting himself to give us the opportunity to do ourselves what we want to do, and we need to be responsible for our actions. This is very important that you keep this idea. Chapter 32. The Lord said to Moses in chapter 32, verse 7, he said, look at what is happening over there. He didn't know, and he asked with the tablets, you know, and he didn't see really what was happening. But the Creator said, go to see these people, because those people are the worst. Look at what they are doing. Then, and in verse 10, the Creator said to him, and now leave me alone, because I am really mad. Okay? And I'm going to destroy all of them. And I'm going to give you a new people, a great people. Look at Moshe Rabbeinu. Think about this, because it's important that you see what I am going. Moshe Rabbeinu has been from the beginning a reluctant leader. Always has been in this interchange with the Creator. Your people. God said, look at what your people are doing. Here he said, look at, go down, look at what your people is doing. That's what the Creator said to Moshe. And Moshe will say to the Creator, look at what your people, that the one that you deliver, has done. Both look like they're blaming each other. They're like a playing ping pong.
Husband and wife said, your son.
You know? Exactly. Then, it's like a husband and wife when they say, you know, yes, when the son does something bad, look at what your son is doing. No, and then both are in this problem.
When they do something good, they say, that's my son.
That's my son, exactly. Then Moshe start when he say, you know, look at what he say in verse 10. I'm going to give you le goy gadol, a great people. You know? And then Moshe comes and is going to convince the Creator. We saw that with Abraham Avinu too, that he convinced the Creator, he changed his mind. You know? When I see those people saying this, I need to have a little bit of patience to take a little bit of air and calm myself down. You know? There is a big reason why the Creator is doing that to Moshe Rabbeinu. Until this time, Moshe Rabbeinu has not appropriate the people of Israel as his people. Psychologically speaking, let me tell you this way. He knew from the beginning that he was a Hebrew. When he was young, one day he went out and saw an Egyptian beating up a Hebrew one. And he got so mad and defended, because he always was to defend justice. He looked for justice. And he defended his own Hebrew people against this Egyptian, and he killed the Egyptian and hided the Egyptian. The next day, he goes back again, and he sees two Hebrews fighting against each other. And he goes and trying to separate them. They say, don't kill each other. And one of them say, oh, you are the one. You are going to kill me too. Like you did yesterday to the Egyptian. And this Hebrew, big mouth, the Jewish people, the Israelites, they went to Pharaoh to tell what he has done. And because of that, he needed to flee. Let me ask you something. If somebody does something, do you want to be your friend again? You don't want. You cut with them. Why must you remain and say, this is not my people anymore. I am a Midianite now. He graduated as a Midianite. You know? And comes the burning bush and this experience and the Creator saying, come, and man, he used every excuse that he could. But he was not getting it. And at the end, again, Aaron came into the picture. And he brings Aaron. I think the Creator saw something in Aaron that we are not able to see. Okay? And Aaron became his partner. Anyway, at this moment, we're still in that situation. I am doing because you told me. I am taking them out of Egypt because you told me. I am going through this way because your cloud and your fire, they're going with me. I am happy because you are there. You are the one that's doing it. I don't have anything to do. It's your people. Well, then Moshe start begging the Lord, our God. Why you are so mad against these people? That you, just before, God said to Moshe, your people. And what is saying Moshe right now? Your people. People of whom it is? Is God's people or Moshe's people? Okay, well, they say, you took it out of the land of Egypt with great power and with high hand. Why are you going to allow the Egyptians again to get a sense of victory after all that you have done for them, no? And then he goes even to the Kishkish, to the Tripas. You're Ladino, no? Goes and asks, don't you remember you promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? Or you forgot already? Moshe talking to the Creator in that way. You know? This is to make it very interesting for you to read. Okay? Remember them. And then verse 14, then the Creator changed his mind. And he allowed, I won't destroy anyway. No? Then, and Moshe came back and he went down to the mountain and he found himself with the reality of what was happening, and he got very mad. And he brought the tablets and everything else. And he was the one now that he wanted to kill the Israelis, not the Creator, to the point that he sent his men to kill 3,000. You see, look like that. He is the one that interceding for his people. So please don't get so mad. Nothing has happened. He goes down and he sees what was really happening. They have committed the worst sin that they have committed. Idolatry. They have changed their God. Even though they say, that was not like that. Give me a break, read the scriptures. Yes, it was not all Israel, but it was the culprits, and they were allowed because they were maybe the mafia of Israel. They had the weapons and everything. They were the macho men. Okay. Verse 28. The Levites took side with Moshe Rabbeinu, and in that day, they killed 3,000 men. They consecrated to the Lord, and for him was a blessing for the Creator. Now, verse 31, this is the other side. And then I'm going to tell you a little bit more, but I want that you see the portions. Moshe came back to the Lord, and he implored to him. I know, he said, he recognized, Israel has committed a great sin. Now, let me ask you something, only for matter of discussion. Most of the rabbis, they blame the Erev Rab. Why she doesn't say, the Erev Rab make us doing that? You see, that is a totally a rabbinical invention to try to clear the reputation of Israel. And this is the problem when we do that. We need to accept ourselves how we are, and we need to go to the Creator, and we need to confess, and we need to do teshuvah the way that we need to do, and we become clean. Nobody is asking you to be Superman. But they're asking you to be just and to be honest. There is no one among us that is perfect. No one. And if any of you think is perfect, I think you are wasting your time to be here. Okay? Then he say, they have committed a great sin. They made themselves a golden god. No, that they didn't think it was a god. It was only, give me a break. Is this here say the golden god? And now, please, forgive them. Please, forgive them. Have you seen? You people, my people. Suddenly now, Moshe Rabbeinu is interceding for his people. And he, what he's doing? Appropriating them. In the narrative here, the problem is that we don't see it immediately, but when we look at more in depth, we're going to see that it's the Creator who is playing with Moses. He's showing Moses how much he cares about his people, even that he says that he doesn't care. Of course, it's very difficult to be a leader of a people that are called Keshech Orech. The Creator called it Keshech Orech, and Moshe Rabbeinu said, you are right, they are Keshech Orech. You know? Let me tell you how many times I have been trying to leave this place. Why? Because we have some Keshech Orech. We have very stiff neck, including myself. I don't want to blame anybody with you, see, including myself. I am in the same position. You know? We can stand each other. But you are my people. Yes, sometimes I would like to check me out of you, but I cannot. No, I need to go with you. Moshe Rabbeinu having the same situation. And he said, and the Lord, and before this, and I'm jumping something that's very important. Please forgive them. They make a golden god. Please, please forgive them their sin. Please forgive them. But if you do not do it, please take me. 32. Please erase me from your book. Please erase me from your book. That sounds familiar to other religions, that somebody give their life for their friends. You know? I want to be the substitute for the sins of my people. Sound familiar to some of you? I'm going to die for them, to save them. What the Torah say? What the Creator say? Verse 33. And the Lord answered to Moshe, I only erase from my book the one that has committed sin. Very simple. But I want to pay for their sins. I am giving myself. I'm going to suffer for them. This is a basic principle in the Torah. You made it, you pay it. Simple. Not with all hula hula, bula bula, the only thing that theology and all those things that the people are going to teach you, somebody else is going to pay for you. We love that somebody pay for me. I love to go free, somebody pay for me. You know? Here is saying, you do it, you pay. And that has no change. Some people think they can get free of that, doing certain things. First of all, you cannot buy the Creator. You cannot fool the Creator. And you cannot buy anybody else to pay for you. For more than all the person needs your money. At the end, you are going to be in front of the Creator. You need to make it right or wrong. This is the basic principle that I want to teach you. Moshe Rabbeinu didn't change the mind of the Creator. The Creator is not a wishy-washy that he changed his mind when you convince him. You are not smarter than the Creator to convince him about something. Believe me, doesn't matter how smart you are. You cannot. The Creator allows you to intercede. The Creator allows you to talk on behalf of somebody. In Judaism, we call it the zehut. You know, the merits. Okay? And we can intervene. We can intercede. That doesn't mean that we change the mind's Creator. You know, we call Rahuto Sehut Abot, and we say also Rahot Besehuto Shel HaMashiach, in the merits of the Messiah. I have not talked to you in the portion before about the anointing, because it was anointing the tent, anointing the utensils, and you can anoint a man. The anointing is because you are whole for a specific reason. That's what means Mashiach. Anyway, let me close now and let me finish in this simple way. I told you about the idea of the wedding. You know, that the Creator could have a divorce immediately. Moshe Rabbeinu acted as the best man. He went to bring the ketubah, and what was the chuppah? The Hashamayim, the heavens, and that was with the groom and the bride. And even though the bride has been always unfaithful, I'm sorry, I say always, because you read the prophet. Let me ask you this question. At this moment I am talking to you, is Israel faithful? Remember, the golden calf is still active. I remember when I was, one day I was in Jerusalem, and I took a taxi. And I was making a conversation with the taxist. And I say, wow, Israel is really, you know, because you, every time that you go to Israel, every 3 months, you find a new road. They build something. If you are not from there, you get lost very quickly. Okay. And I was asking, look, really, Israel is getting more productive, more wealthy. And you know what was his answer to me? All of us here, we worship the golden calf. That was his answer. Very sad. Well, let me finish in a good term. And the parasha of this week is also Shabbat Parah. You know, the red cow, the red heifer. And this is something that is a hookah, a hook, the hookim, but it's a hook, is something that we do not understand completely. But we see there a picture that always our Creator wants to cleanse us. It's a process of cleansing. Only if we go to Him. The cleansing process begins when we go to Him. And how is the only way that we can go to Him? When we acknowledge who we really are. And we're trying to make it right. We're returning to the Creator. Our Messiah Yeshua gave us a beautiful mashal, a parable, about the prodigal son. You remember? Some of you remember? And what is the mashal? It's about a son of a very rich father. And one day he decided to take all his inheritance and go to the world. And he threw away everything. He did everything evil in the eyes of anybody that can imagine. And he went so low that he started to survive, start taking care of the porks. And he will fight with the pork for the food because he has anything to eat. The pigs, pork. No,
pork
no.
Is after
oh, for the pigs. Sorry. Okay. And what happened there is that he's one day he became smart. She say, in the house of my father, even the lowest of the lowest of the lowest of the lowest of the servants live better than the way that I am. And I'm going back to my father. And I'm going to ask him to receive me as the lowest of the lowest of the lowest servant. And he came back and he confessed and said, Father, I have done wrong. Then please receive me as only as your servant. And the father, what he did? A big party, a feast. My son is back. Each one of us, we have that opportunity. We are all his children. And we can come back to him only to do the Teshuvah. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom.